Hi, I'm Karen Vecchio, your Member of Parliament for Elgin-Middlesex-London, and this is your weekly report for May 3rd to May 7th. This week, all Canadians received a 2021 census form in the mail. The information provided in the 2021 census is used by communities, businesses and governments to plan services and make information decisions about employment, education, healthcare, market development and more. To complete your online census, visit census.gc.ca and enter the 16-digit secure access code that you received in the mail. If you'd prefer to receive a paper questionnaire, please call 1-877-885-2021. By law, your responses will be kept confidential. I also want to highlight an amazing project in St. Thomas with the partnership with Doug Terry, the YWCA St. Thomas Elgin, and Sanctuary Homes. The project Tiny Home will create energy-efficient, supportive, affordable housing and consist of a cluster of tiny homes and a low-rise apartment at 21 Keynes Street, the former home of Elgin Handels. Congratulations to this group for spearheading this project and your vision for St. Thomas. This week, Conservatives continue to fight against Bill C-10 and the threat it poses to free speech online in our country. Although the government pretends that there's nothing wrong with the bill, they've started to indicate that they will bring forward new amendments to fix the major problems with this bill. However, we aren't out of the woods yet, so continue to make your voice heard on this issue. Canadians are speaking with a unified voice, and together we can make it clear that Canadians' rights to free speech will always triumph over Liberal spin. Another key event this week was the emergency debate on the Enbridge Line 5 pipeline. The governor of Michigan has renewed efforts to shut down Line 5 this month. This move will be absolutely devastating for Canada and our region in particular. This pipeline provides half of the crude oil needs of Ontario and Quebec and provides thousands of jobs in Sarnia. Specific to this motion, I received great feedback from our very own Elgin-Middlesex-London resident, the former chair of the Canadian Propane Association, and a local CFO for a local fuel delivery business, Dan Kelly. The motion states that given that the government has failed to make any meaningful progress with either the U.S. administration or the governor of Michigan on ensuring that Line 5 pipeline remains open, that Line 5 is a critical piece of infrastructure, and that Line 5 is, one, is a project of critical importance that provides vital energy infrastructure from Western Canada throughout the U.S. and into Ontario and Quebec. We also have to remind ourselves that its significant impact on Atlantic Canada, as refineries in Montreal are served by Line 5 as well, which in turn provides finished product to Eastern Quebec and the Atlantic provinces. Point two, Line 5 provides essential fuel to Ontario and Quebec in a more economical, safe, and environmentally sustainable manner than other forms of transit. Here we have to note that other forms of transit also include barging and refined product through the Great Lakes in larger tanker ships. Barging cannot be any safer than Line 5. Point three, if Line 5 is shut down, it can result into up to an additional 2,000 trucks or 800 rail cars to ensure supply is maintained, which will lead to higher greenhouse gas emissions and costs. This is where we have to note that these trucks and rail cars in the number of that can arrive to an Ontario orbit on a daily basis. Given it be multiple trips into Sarnia, the number of trucks and rail cars needed is to multiply that number. These vehicles need to arrive full, offload, then return empty for another trip. Depending on where the trip originates, it could be up to a week to complete this cycle. Our propane from Western Canada takes 12 days to arrive for Edmonton, for example. Also, we have a severe shortage of licensed drivers here in Canada. No idea where we're going to find drivers for these 2,000 trucks, let alone finding the tankers and rail cars. Point three, Line 5 represents thousands of jobs for Ontarians, Quebecers, and Western Canadians. Jobs desperately needed for our economic recovery following the pandemic. We know that agriculture use is massive both to heat the barns and dry crops, but manufacturing jobs are also significant as propane is a key input in the manufacturing of plastics. Electric cars can require far more plastic than regular vehicles as they need to offset the weight of the batteries with lightweight plastics. Thus, saving emissions still requires increased use of petrochemicals. Point four, Line 5 is essential for keeping the heat on the thousands of people in Ontario and Quebec. Over 500,000 Canadians in Ontario and Quebec and Atlantic Canada rely on propane as their home energy fuel, not just heat for cooking and even lighting. Point five, Line 5 represents a critical source of fuel for numerous farming and industrial communities. Farming numbers need to include heat for livestock, as this has been overlooked in the favor of grain drying. In Ontario and Eastern Canada, these volumes are significant. Industries and institutions that are outside of the natural gas grid rely on propane. Small companies, schools, health facilities, long-term care, small businesses, and some manufacturing require propane to provide energy. Point six, Line 5 provides all of the jet fuel for Toronto's Pearson International Airport, Canada's largest airport. We know that a great amount, the majority of the fuel comes through Line 5. Point seven, Line 5 is critical to securing our energy security and economic future. Absolutely. No idea how we'd replace the energy provided by Line 5 by May 13th. We may eventually be able to find alternatives through a combination of barge, rail, and trucks, but there's no way the alternatives could be safer than Line 5. Finally, on Thursday, I was also able to give my response to the federal budget in the House of Commons. My full speech is already up on my website and social media platforms, so please make sure you take a look. Unfortunately, the final thing I'm going to share with you today is this week that the government failed to take any accountability for their failure of our women in the Canadian Armed Forces. The Prime Minister continues to claim that every top staffer in his office, the Minister of National Defence's office, and the Clerk of the Privy Council all knew about the allegations of top General Jonathan Vance, but he was left in the dark. If this is true, it's a massive failure for the Prime Minister's office, and so Conservatives called for the resignation of the Prime Minister's Chief of Staff, Katie Telford, who also apparently knew about the allegations and didn't pass it along to the Prime Minister. One thing remains clear. This government has no sense of accountability when push comes to shove. My colleagues and I will work to hold them to account every step of the way. Now, finally, on a lighter note, we had the chance to celebrate some special days this week. May the 4th was always fun for my Star Wars loving family, and I hope everyone at Elgin-Middlesex-London had a great Cinco de Mayo as well. Have a great weekend, and I hope to see you next week.